Good morning, Bell Road. How's everybody doing this morning? Oh, it's so great to be here. Let's stand for the reading of God's Word. This passage is from John, chapter 17, starting at 20. It's Christ, and he's pleading with the Father to be with the disciples and to be with us. I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who believe in me through their message. I pray that they will be all one, just as you and I are one. As you are in me, Father, and I am in you. And may they be in us, so that the world will believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, so they may be one as we are one. I am in them, and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me and that you love me as much as you love me. And that you love them as much as you love me. Father, I want these whom you have given me to be with me where I am. Then they can see all the glory you gave me because you loved me even before the world began. O righteous Father, the world doesn't know you, but I do. And these disciples know you sent me. I have revealed you to them, and I will continue to do so. Then your love for me will be in them, and I will be in them. Amen?
Amen.
Father, today, as we come before you in worship, and as we want to just pour out our praise to you, would you make yourself known to us? God, maybe we're not in a place to worship you right now. And I pray that we would just bring anything in our hearts before you and just bow it down. Anything that would be in the way of worshiping you. Speak through your word today. Speak through these songs. God, just take a second and let's just focus on you. We love you, God, so much.
Christ will give us light. He will have died. We'll turn to Him in song. Wake Him at dawn.
Let's sing that again.
Wake from your sleep. Rise from the dead. Christ will give us sight.
Thank you.
Under your lordship. We know that you have the power to free us from anything in our lives. Things that are holding us back, things that we keep running to. And we need you to do that in our lives, God. We need you to have power and lordship in our lives. God, one way we can do that is we can give you our full mind and our full heart as we dig into your word today. May we just let you speak to us through your word today. Father, we love you. You're our master. And God, when we're following you, that's where the peace is. When we are in Christ, and Christ is in us, as he is in you, God, that's where the peace is. That's where we're supposed to be, in step with you. So I pray that we would just take a few moments and just surrender ourselves to you. Just say, God, we will follow you. We'll make that decision, God. You are good to us, God. So good to us, so consistent, faithful every morning. We say these things in your name. Amen.
Two years ago, I preached on the subject of unity. And I know that most of you will remember that. Actually, most of you were not there when I preached it because I was in the early service. But I felt like that since unity is one of the most vital things that we can just absolutely put into our hearts and hold on to. Most important things for a church of Jesus Christ. Passage that John read a few moments ago, the 21st verse, he said, this was Jesus' prayer. If you remember, he mentioned that he had been praying for the disciples, the disciples that were then following Jesus. And then in the 20th verse, he was praying to the Father. He said, I'm not just praying for these, but all of those who will believe through their word. Their word. So we believed. In other words, Jesus was praying for you and me. And he started on that 20th verse. And he said in the 21st verse, I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one. We're talking about, he said, I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one. The same unity between the Father and the Son, he prayed that we would have and hold on to. I want you to know today, and I want to emphasize that's absolutely fantastic. That Jesus, it was Jesus who prayed for me and for you. And what he prayed, of all of the things that he might have prayed, you know, he could have prayed that Doc would become a millionaire. Richard's laughing. You don't see me laughing. But we know that that would have been absolutely stupid. He's not that way. But he prayed for one of the most precious, precious, precious things that could be a reality when it's genuine among his people. And in that passage that John read, he explained why. Because when that's happening, then the world begins to realize what's happening in terms of why the Father sent Jesus. And he went on to say that when the world gets to know that, then they also will believe. It's fantastic that he prayed, of all of the things that he could have prayed, he prayed for unity, for you and me, for us. It's not only fantastic that he prayed for unity, but what the beauty that flowed along with that plea to the Father, which was the love. Which without that, there is no unity. And the glory. All of this, absolutely fantastic. But the implication of this is that it'll make a difference in the world. But not only that, it'll make a difference in you and me. Because you see, when there is genuine love and genuine unity, and it will become, they will become, that is, love and unity will become reciprocal. Because the greater the love, the greater the quality of love, the greater the quality of unity. The greater the quality of unity, the love will become greater. God works that way. But one of the most beautiful things about this is that when we really realize what's happening, when among Christians there is genuine unity, what we must realize is that this is something that is supernatural. It is not human in terms of natural humanity. It is not. This is something that God and God only can do. And that's what makes it so beautiful. It's no wonder to us that he prayed for unity, because it's absolutely beautiful. I want us to remember, and you hear me say this over and over again, that what we're all about as human beings, not just Christians, but human beings, but especially Christians, it's all about relationships. Our relationship, first of all, to God, and then to our fellow human being, and especially to one another. It's absolutely essential. Unity is one of the most beautiful qualities in human relationships. Disunity is the ugliest and worst possible problem among human relationships, because there can be no quality in relationships when there is disunity. You know, Jesus, I think that he must have realized this back in eternity past and looked down through the corridors of time and saw our lives. In anticipation, anticipated the possibility or the potential of disunity, the possibility of disunity, even among Christians. Certainly there would be, without question, the potential of the problems which cause disunity, the divisions, dividing. It's human. He would have anticipated that. Jesus, on one occasion, in the 12th chapter of the book of Matthew, was having to deal with the Pharisees. And you know those Pharisees, boy, they were united in the worst kind of union that could ever be possible, and they were the most religious people that you can imagine. I didn't say spiritual. I said religious. And they were giving him all kinds of problems. And he said to them, Jesus knew what was in their heart. He said, Jesus knew what they were thinking, so he said to them. And this is what he's saying to us today. Just the most logical thing. Any country that divides itself will not last very long. Any town or family that divides itself into groups which fight each other will fall apart. So with one group fighting another, in Satan's kingdom, this means that it is already divided into groups and will soon fall apart. You know what he was saying? He's saying where there's disunity, there's things fall apart. But in this particular passage, in essence, he was saying, he said, if it's already fighting, you know, there's already groups, it's already divided. He said, into groups. Okay, here's you got some groups, but it won't be long. You got these groups are divided. And these groups, little group, until there is no unity whatsoever. There's no relationships whatsoever. We're just nothing. Well, that's nothing, isn't it? Excuse me. Jesus was saying, it all falls apart. That unity in a town falls apart. Disunity in a town, it falls apart. Disunity in a family, it falls apart. You know, perhaps we haven't noticed. Perhaps we have noticed. I'm sure we have. But we're living in a world of human relationships that's falling apart. A world that's falling apart. As Christians, we are in this world, but God never intended for us to be a part of the problem. And you know, part of the problem is when we're at any state of disunity. Because, see, disunity generates disunity, just like unity will energize unity. It just works that way. In 1 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter, 3rd verse, the Apostle Paul recognized that there were some of the Christians there that were just not acting like Christians. And he just wanted to give them a little logic. So he approached it like this, kind of diplomatically. You are still carnal. That's diplomatic. That's probably about as diplomatic as he could have been. You are still carnal. And then he begins to get a little logic in there. He says, for while there is envy, strife, disunity, when that division's among you, are you not still carnal or worldly? Are you not behaving like mere people and not like Christians? Pretty logical. He says, I have arrived at this, that you're still carnal, he says, based on the fact that I see what's going on. You can see that in my life, see that in your life when it's there. He was just simply saying that when there's disunity, things fall apart. Jesus prayed for unity because he wanted Christians to stand out in this world with a beautiful difference in order to make a beautiful difference in this world. And you and I both know that that's the only way it's ever going to happen. That's the only way that it ever has ever happened where there was meaningful unity. It's what God does. And he's good at it when we let him do it. Jesus wants Christians to have a real spirit of determination, of holding on. I believe that, relatively speaking, no, a little bit more than that. I believe that there is a spirit of unity in this church. But you know what? We're human beings. Unless there is a spirit, a great tenacity among us, a hold on determination, that we can be just like any other human beings, even though we're Christians. Just told us so. Anything these little things happen, then things begin to fall apart. So we need to be determined, absolutely determined, a hold on spirit. Determination. That's what it's all about. You see, we need to have this determination of this hold on spirit, this unity, perfect unity within our families, within our friends, within our church, and as a church within this world to make a difference. No, in Auburn, to make a difference. I don't know if you know this or not, but you don't even have to look. You can pretty well guess that Auburn could use a difference. And God wants his people, to be the one to make the difference. I got to remember what Jesus said, that the world may know, that Auburn may know, that Auburn may believe. That's exactly what he said, the passage that John read, that Auburn would believe. You see, my family is a part of my world. My wife is a part of my world. My children, my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren, they're all a part of my world. You're a part of my world. A very important part of my world. And what happens in this heart, within the inner being of this person, is going to make a difference. In this world. In this world. And in that heart will make a difference in this world. It's just the way it works. As Christians, Christianity, unity makes a difference. Tremendous difference. As Christians, we must be very serious about this business of just holding on. And whatever the relationships are. But we're talking about church right now. Very important. I want us to think about this determination. You remember, some of you may remember 2 years ago when I talked about the bristlecone pine tree. I don't know if you realize it. The bristlecone pine tree is a native of California. Is the oldest growing tree in the world. And if it's still growing, now it's been a little while since I talked with somebody about this. Now, when I talked to one of my deacons one day, who's one of the lead men in the agricultural department at the University at Chico. We were talking about this one day, and he told me that one of those trees is still living. 4,600 years old, they believe. You know, that's not bad. That's not bad, is it? You want to tell you? That blows my noggin, I'll tell you. It just knocks me away. That's hard to believe. But you know what's really interesting about it? I'm not much on agriculture or horticulture or botany or anything like that, but I know that it takes something for plants to grow. And I know the best soil and the best circumstances is always the best to enable them to grow and to keep on growing. But this bristlecone pine tree naturally lives in the most unlikely place for a tree to exist. That's weird. 4,600 years? The most unlikely circumstances. Now, most of us don't realize it, but we are people of unity. But we live in the most unlikely circumstances. We live with other people out yonder. And it has a bearing upon what it could do in our lives. Now, I thought to myself about this particular tree, that one in particular. I thought to myself, if that pine tree could think, I would just have to compliment it and say, boy, what a tremendous determination that you have. You just put your own mind to it and just holding on and holding on. And he can't think. Has nothing to do. His thinking has nothing to do with 4,600 years of living in the midst of unlikely circumstances. But he keeps on and keeps on and holding on and holding. You know why? Because God created that tree. When he created that tree, he put a process into that tree. And that process goes to work. And that old tree hasn't got anything to do with it. It just lets it happen. It just happens. He's not thinking a thing. It's just happening. He's not keeping it from happening. He's not helping it to happen. It's just happening. And this old process just works in this old tree, and it don't make any difference what the circumstances. It just keeps on keeping this whole tree going because the process keeps on going. You know what? I got good news about me. I'm a Christian.
Hallelujah.
There is a process in me. And I didn't put it there. God put it there in the person of Jesus Christ when Christ came into my life. And you know what? As long as that process is working like God wants it to work, then I'm going to keep on growing spiritually. That pine tree, the only thing that's likely to keep that pine tree from growing is to resist the process. But he can't resist the process. But there's a process in me that God put there that I can resist. Because I can think. You wouldn't believe that, but I can think. And as long as I am thinking positively about this, as long as I am, wait a minute, there's another thing, I can resist. But while I'm not resisting, I better be cooperating. Because that's what was happening, this old tree. It wasn't resisting, it was just cooperating. And that process just kept that old tree going and going and going, and he was holding on. Now, I'm still talking about unity. Because you see, what we're talking about here is what God does within us. And God is good at it. That process, God created that in us, and he intends for it to be that which works in us. And we let this happen, and then it becomes what God wants it to become. Let me read. Here's the way it starts in the 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 and 18. He said, whoever is in Christ Jesus, talking about a genuine Christian, Whoever is in Christ Jesus is a new creation. He says, the old is in the past. All has become new. All this is from God through Jesus Christ, he says. That just started just like that when I was 24 years old. It started in my life just like that. That's the starting point. God just made me a whole new creation within. I was only 24 years old. I was just a kid. But you know, while I was still pastor of this church, about half a block down from the church, it was a different location at that time, there was a man there who lived there between 80 and 85 years old. I was thinking he was around 85 years old. But anyway, he was about my age now. And it started in his life at 80-some years old. Imagine that. Brand new, absolutely new, 85 years old. But it was the same process, and it was supernatural. God was doing a work in his life as long as he wasn't resisting, as long as he was cooperating, just like me, as long as I am cooperating with God and not resisting God, something's going on in my life. Something beautiful. You can't tell that from the outside, but it's beautiful, beautiful going on in my life. We're still talking about unity. I hate to say this, but I know that you know it already. But I'm not the only one that's happening in your life, too. You've got that process going on in your life. Exactly the same thing. It started when you started, when you received Christ into your life. And as long as you're not resisting, some beautiful things are happening in your life. You may not even be able to see it, but it's happening. And when you're resisting, when you're cooperating, it's beautiful. When you're resisting, it's pitiful, spiritually. I'm going to read a passage here, if I can find it. Philippians, second chapter. The last passage that I read, that's the way it starts. But this is the way, this is an explanation of how it operates, how it works. Very simple. He said, work out your own salvation with a deep reverence. Okay, now I want you to think about that. Because this is something that when we're working out our own salvation, we're either not resisting or resisting. We're either cooperating or not cooperating, one way or the other. We're working out our own salvation because it says, work out your own salvation, for it is God who is working within you. Now listen real closely. You know about this passage. Working within you, energizing you to be willing. Whether or not I will resist, God is always working there. He wants to do this. He's doing everything in my life that's necessary as long as I am not resisting. But he keeps on anyway, trying to work it, even though I'm resisting, because you know the passage where it says the spirit lusteth against the spirit, the spirit lusteth against the flesh lusteth. There is a battle going on. God is trying to always bring us, energize us to be willing. And then it goes on, to be willing and to be able to do according to his good pleasure. It's the process. We either are willing or we're not willing, but he's always working in our lives to try to get us to. The process is going, the process is moving within us as long as we don't resist. And we're not going to be cooperating as long as we resist. It always works that way. That's the process. Your part of it simply is to cooperate with God while he's accomplishing what he wants to accomplish in your life. See, we're still thinking about unity here. because it is so valuable. It contributes to this using the unity to do the energizing within us, because we have an effect upon one another when that love is present. And there's no unity without that kind of love. I'm talking about supernatural love. I'm talking about God's love manifest in us and through us to one another. It's always necessary. And I hope that we understand something about the process that God worked within us. See, when we cooperate with God, this process, he gives us what it takes to hold on to unity with our fellow Christians and really just to hold on. Tremendous potential in all of this. I want you to see this potential, because there in Ephesians 3:20, it says, "Now unto him that is able to do," we're talking about God who is working within us. "Now unto him who is able to do," oh man, listen to this, "is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think." And that's according to the power that's working in us. That's what it says here. What it says, it's God who's working within us to will and to do. See, Bible tells us that God is able to do super abundantly above all that we ask or think, and something on top of that, more than even that, more than we can even know. In other words, it's so tremendous that's indescribable what God can do in our lives if we're really cooperating with God. You see, I needed to use that bristlecone pine tree to illustrate, because there was such an extremity there, because it was so fantastic, so unbelievable what was going on in that tree's life. But it was going on. Just blow your mind, 4,600 years, still living, and it just goes on. But you know what? That's nothing. That's nothing what that pine tree did compared to what God can do in this world, what God can do in this town, what God can do in this church, when this church is really holding on and allowing his love and his work to take effect in our lives. We're talking about unity. We're talking about a spirit of togetherness. We're talking about genuine Christian fellowship. We're talking about Christianity. It's a beautiful thing. What about motivation? Just one very quickly. All right, I just said it. God can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think because of the work, because he's working within us. If that ought not to motivate us, I don't know. What can? What about his love? Did you remember what John was reading there, what it said? It says that the world may know that you love them as much as you love me, he said. Did you know that God loves you as much as he loves Jesus? Wow. Is that supernatural or not? Wow. Is that motivation? Hey, there is another tree, you know. There is another tree. It's not just the love, but what that love has already done for us. Simon Peter, in 1 Peter, he said, he bore our sins in his own body on the tree. He was talking about the cross. It was Jesus who prayed for you and me. He really did. I'd like for the choir to come forward as the offering bearers come forward.
We'll take the offering and the altar in prayer.
Let's pray. Father, thank you that we have that deep realization within that you're present among us right now. Thank you, Lord. Receive this offering for us, Lord. Be glorified among us because of it. In Jesus' name, amen.